When I think about modeling, I think about describing how phenomena work. And so some things that are called modeling, which they are models, when you create, for example, a 3D structural model, that's a model of something. But there's not a lot of information necessarily there in how that thing works. And so when I think about modeling, I'm always thinking about something that has explanatory and predictive power.
To bring modeling into classrooms means what we want to do is we want to help kids develop these scientific models to explain the world. Not from scratch, with lots of careful guidance by carefully sequencing the kinds of phenomena and questions that we raise about those phenomena.
All models have limitations, and so no model's ever perfect. And what students do when they're debating back and forth about modeling and their various models that they have is they're pushing each other's boundaries of what are the limitations of your model? How is that model going to work to explain the phenomena that we see before us, and how might we apply that to some new ideas or related phenomena?
So, you know, when scientists use models, obviously their models are always tentative, and much of their interactions with their peers revolves around, you know, the ability of their models to predict and explain the phenomena that they're interested in, right? And whose model maybe does that slightly more effectively or whatever. And so over time, through this community process, through a whole network of scientists, we arrive at more predictive and more powerful models that help us understand our world better.
And so I think modeling is a key practice that all scientists do, and that for us to not include that as an everyday kind of experience in science classrooms would do a disservice to our students.